Funding for this firing line debate is made possible by a major grant from the Hatton W. Sumner's Foundation. Additional funding is provided by the John M. Olin Foundation, the Annenberg Foundation, and the Laurel Foundation.
University in Houston, Texas, welcome to a special firing line debate on the environment. The exact wording of our resolution tonight is, resolved, the environmentalists are going too far, too fast. Just a couple of years ago, it looked as if the environmental movement wasn't going anywhere except the compost heap. Republicans had won control of Congress, promising to roll back government regulation of business, and environmentalism seemed to be out of fashion. There was even talk of weakening the Clean Air Act. But in the most recent election, the environment turned out to be a popular issue for the Democrats. They accused the Republicans of going too far, too fast, and backing away from environmental protection. Today, there is talk of tightening the Clean Air Act. Rules protecting wetlands have already been tightened, and President Clinton turned a large chunk of southern Utah into a protected wilderness. Environmentalism has been part of all of our lives since the first Earth Day a generation ago. Recycling the trash is now a major life activity, separating this from that, bundling the one, composting the other, and so on and so forth. Has all this effort and money made the world a better place, or has environmentalism become counterproductive? That's the issue. So now let's welcome tonight's debaters. The captain of the affirmative team, of course, is William F. Buckley, Jr. As the author of several dozen books, the founder of National Review magazine, and the writer of columns that run in hundreds of newspapers, Mr. Buckley is personally responsible for the destruction of more trees than almost any other living American. He is also, of course, the founder and star of Firing Line, so we forgive him. Joining Mr. Buckley on the affirmative team is Jerry Jasinowski, president of the National Association of Manufacturers. NAM is the leading trade and lobbying group of business and industry. Mr. Jasinowski has been its president since 1990. He is also the author of Making It in America, which is not about manufacturing. Its subtitle is Proven Paths to Success from 50 Top Companies. Richard Schmalensee is a professor of economics at MIT and director of MIT's Center for Energy and Environmental Policy Research. He served on President George Bush's Council of Economic Advisors and still serves on the Environmental Economics Advisory Board of the Environmental Protection Agency. To top it off, Dr. Schmalensee is a director of the Long Island Lighting Company, the notorious LILCO. Finally on the affirmative team is Senator Larry Craig of Idaho. Senator Craig is chairman of the Republican Policy Committee. According to his official biography, he is, quote, a forceful advocate for common sense and conservative solutions. Now, you can't have it both ways, Senator. What'll it be tonight, common sense or conservative solutions? I hope you'll make up your mind. Captain of the opposition team is Eugene Linden, a writer for Time magazine. Mr. Linden's articles for Time have included stories about the environmental destruction in Siberia and the precarious existence of the wild tiger. He's at work now on a book about life in the next century. According to his biography, Mr. Linden pioneered the so-called Written to Space article for Time magazine, which apparently means letting the writer go on as long as he or she wants to. Based on my own experience as a magazine editor, that's not too good for the trees either. Jerry Brown was governor of California for 8 years. He has also run for president 8 times, or does it only seem like 8 times?
Only three.
3 times.
So far.
So far. As governor, he made California probably the most environmentally advanced state in the country. More recently, he has championed the cause of campaign spending reform and is host of a radio program, We the People with Jerry Brown. George Woodwell is founder and president of the famous Woods Hole Research Center in Massachusetts. He was also a founder of the Natural Resources Defense Council, a founder of the Environmental Defense Fund, a founder of the World Resources Institute, and chairman of the World Wildlife Fund, which I think about covers it. If environmentalism has gone too far, it's pretty clear that Dr. Woodwell must be to blame. About the only environmental group Dr. Woodwell didn't seem to found is the Sierra Club. And to cover that omission, he's on the board?
He's too young.
Too young. Well, to cover that omission, we've got Carl Pope, who you just met, executive director of the Sierra Club since 1992. Mr. Pope, no relation to that other Pope, also serves on the board of a variety of pro-environmental groups, including Zero Population Growth. So you know he's not related to that other Pope. I'm the moderator tonight. My name is Mike Kinsley, and I'm the editor of Slate Magazine. At Slate, we do our bit for the trees by publishing on the internet in cyberspace. And our address is www.slate.com. And with apologies, for that plug, I call upon Mr. Buckley to propose tonight's motion. Mr. Buckley.
Mr. Chairman, if you know anybody who prefers unclean air or dirty water or barren forest lands, pray keep him away from here and pray for him. The affirmative side happily concedes the historic advances in environmentalist goals, acknowledges gratefully the aid in this endeavor by sensible Democrats, and most quietly and modestly pauses to record that the father of the environmental movement in this century was a Republican president. But we all recognize that pretty good movements sometimes end up in fanatical hands. The credenda of the Muslims have much to commend them, but the ideals of Mohammed are difficult to spot through the murk of the Ayatollahs. The First Amendment of the Constitution is a glorious reification of human rights, except when it tells us that a community may not ban the public showing of deep throat or tolerate a mayor's exposure of the Ten Commandments. Our contention is that some fanatics and some apprentice fanatics, in their search for long lies for the spotted owl and solicitude for clement global temperature, are here and there losing perspective. If relaxing laws on the use of asbestos would result in the death, say, by cancer of 1 out of 15 million people exposed to that asbestos, is that the sufficient consideration for forbidding its use? Or ought it to be weighed against the 8,000 people who, because of that asbestos, will be shielded from fiery deaths? If it requires $170 billion to purify 24% of the hazardous waste sites, could it be that the standards we are insisting upon are unrealistic? We acknowledge that different standards of air purity are required for an operating room than for a men's smoker. Aren't we entitled, indeed required, to evaluate in other situations, what is appropriate for some references, with some references to reality, and some appreciation of the high cost of environmental scrupulosity. Now, last year, our environment programs cost every American household $1,800. The common concern, Mr. Chairman, should be to conceive and to encourage a happy fusion between individual rights and the common objective. And the laws we endorse should accommodate varied responses, adjusted to individual convenience and exigency. It does not profit the spotted owl to encourage a landowner to seek it out to be shot, lest its appearance immobilize the development of his property. Perhaps in our exchanges today, we can forward the search for a non-fanatical pursuit of a common objective. In our struggle against poverty, it is not recommended to do away with wealth. And in the struggle for clean air, it should not be encouraged to repeal the Industrial Revolution. Over, Mr. Chairman, to the negative, let there be light.
Thank you, Mr. Buckley. Mr. Linden, I think we will call them the opposition team, not the negative team, if that's okay. to lead off for the opposition.
Well, as a journalist, I would like you to call me the objective team. And as a journalist, I haven't the slightest hesitation in opposing the resolution of the evening. The last 2 years, environmentalists, as Mr. Kingley have pointed out, spent most of their time in a rearguard action trying to prevent a rollback of environmental legislation. The Clinton administration was supine on the issue until the notorious Dick Morris alerted him to an electoral opportunity in 1995. The years before that, the Bush administration, there was some progress, but of course, 8 years of the Reagan administration, there was also a vigorous attempt to weaken and roll back environmental laws, and so you have to go back to the late 70s before you find any too far or even progress in environmental legislation. The U.S. has had some successes. Delaware Bay has been cleaned up. World War II, pilots could smell it at 5,000 feet, and it now supports a multi-billion dollar recreational industry. I guess you could call that a giving rather than a taking. Similarly, the Hudson River, where I live, now teeming with striped bass again, although there's still progress to be made upstream. The grizzly bear, the bald eagle have come back. Wolves are back in Yellowstone. But the loss of wet wildlands continues. The United States World Resources Institute just did a study of the world's forests looking at satellite data. The U.S. is one of 76 countries that have less than 1% of their frontier forest remaining. Wetlands continue to decrease. These vital filters that not only screen out pollutants, but act as a coastal barrier and provide habitat and nurseries for both fish and wildlife. Around the world, the situation is bleak. The notion that we've gone too far too fast in global terms is laughable. Again, deforestation continues apace, and 80% of the world's frontier forests have disappeared. 76, as I pointed out, of 123 countries have no, 76 out of 123 have no forest remaining. 18 have only 5%. Only 8 countries, among them Brazil, Russia, and Canada, have substantial portions of their original frontier forests. Water will be a major issue in the next century as finite supplies have increasing competition as cities, agriculture, and wildfowl and wildlife all compete for the same diminishing resource. The loss of diversity around the world continues, and diversity, we've discovered, is not just an amenity issue. It is vital for the functioning of ecosystems. We see a resurgence in infectious disease throughout the world, in part because of changing climate, whether natural or anthropogenic, but also in part because of the loss of diversity in ecosystems that used to control disease, Lyme disease in the Northeast, which has now spread throughout the country, being a case in point. Most of the world's fisheries are in trouble. Many of the, a good proportion of the world's coral reefs, which are the nurseries of the ocean, are in trouble. Algal blooms, which are, were host to the latest cholera epidemic in Latin America, are spreading and blooming all around the world. In atmospheric terms, we have this one great success, which was the ozone treaty. Would anyone argue that we've gone too fast, too far in controlling stratospheric chemicals, destroying stratospheric ozone, since we were going to be stuck with the consequences of the existing ozone depletion for the next 60 years. Then, if we've gone too fast, why is it the Wall Street Journal is trumpeting that the world is entering a new golden era of world trade and the world economy? Well, global economic growth is now at about 4% a year, which was regarded as inconceivable just a few years ago. Similarly, the U.S. is now regarded as best poised in a competitive position to both to take part in this global trade and to be in the best competitive position to dominate it. And I think Mr. Jasinowski has made the point and that we are, has made the point that the U.S. is in that position. If, in fact, environmental regulations are such a drag, how is it that we have such growth? Maybe we need more environmental rules, regulations, more environmental ethos to have further growth in the future. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Linden. Jerry and Jerry, Mr. Jasinowski and Mr. Brown. And Mr. Jasinowski will start with an opening statement.
Thank you very much, Michael, and thank you for everyone for joining us today. I think, first of all, everyone would agree with what Bill said about us all being committed, at least as far as I know, to improving the environment. And the success we've had over the last several years indicates that. We've improved the air about a third over 25 years, while the population grew a third, and at the same time, our economy doubled in size. So notwithstanding the fact, Gene, that there are cases where we have big problems, we've had big successes, and I would certainly echo your view that the stratospheric effort was a success, and there are many. And what we ought to do is to try to find ways to work together in order to achieve that. The problem is that too often there are cases where instead of looking at the science, looking at the economics, we race ahead in a not very careful way, and we do a lot of harm when we do that. And I'd like to suggest, just to start it out, that the global climate change issue is one of those, and make two points to suggest that we are in fact going too far, too fast. First of all, we're certainly going too fast in that we've got so many issues that are not settled on the global climate issue with respect to the science, what should the goal be, what should the regime be that includes compliance, should developing countries be involved or not involved, and we're supposed to do all of that in 6 months, which we just can't do. Secondly, we're going too far in that we're throwing ourselves into an international regime where we don't know what the role of developing countries is going to be, and we're told that they're not going to be included. And as a result, the AFL-CIO Executive Council has said, by exempting developing nations from any further commitments, the Berlin Mandate ensures that there will be no meaningful worldwide effort to stabilize atmospheric concentrations. That means it won't work.
Thank you. Mr. Brown.
The issue, as I see it, is not so much economic or scientific, it's fundamentally moral, or any other word that would describe how we understand our place in the world. Philosophers, theologians, for millennia have warned against pride, envy, greed, and gluttony. None of those show up in the economist mythology of unending consumption and impact. When there are 250 million people in the world with spears and primitive tools, the impact was minimal. When there's 6 billion, as there are today, moving to 10 or 14 billion with powerful technologies and a philosophy of non-satiety, never enough, we get the very problem that is the subject of this debate. People moving to restrict the deleterious impact on the environment are not moving too fast, they're moving too slow. There needs to be a principle of enoughness. The Manufacturers Association and the other advocates for more impact in the world have no principle of enoughness, no personal restraint that would allow human beings to live in harmony with God's creation. That is the challenge. It's moral, it's theological, and it's philosophical. A understanding of man's place in the world, limits, wisdom. We have the tools, we have the technology, but we lack the wisdom to make our way on a sustainable basis. That is really the turning point of this kind of debate.
Thank you. Mr. Jasinowski.
Well, Governor, I'm pleased that you up front, put it on what I guess you could characterize as a religious basis, because I think that's a lot of what the debate is about. The issue is, are we going to try to look at reasoning on science and figure out what's the best thing to do on the global climate or clean air, and what are we going to do to implement it economically? So let me just ask you, you can say it's not a matter of economics, but we've had this success with economics. Are you for repealing the Industrial Revolution?
Transforming the Industrial Revolution. There's no God-given mandate to some notion called Industrial Revolution when it distorts human nature and violates every principle of common sense. What is enough? And in my turn to question you, I'm going to ask you, is there any principle of limitation, or is it just unlimited accumulation and impact? And that is not sustainable, and it's morally indefensible.
Well, I think you won't have to wait to question me on it, Governor, because in fact, it's obvious you don't understand what modern industry is all about. If you looked at the comeback of American industry and the quality movement in this country, you would recognize that we already think that oftentimes small is better. If you look at the 3M program on environmental improvement, they don't have any waste because they recycle it, and lots of other companies do that. So there is a modern industrial movement. Why is it that you suggest there isn't, and that we're all just people who want more?
I'll tell you why, because there's over 4 billion tons of accumulating CO2, which is raising the climate. It's having an impact. The scientists will say on our side that it's a negative impact, but no one here can predict the full long-term consequences. For what? For excess. And there is no limitation. Your program is more and more of what? More wisdom, more quality, more friendship? No, more stuff extracted from the earth, processed into waste, with these kind of effects that no one can deny. There is more buildup of greenhouse gases. There's more destruction of the ozone layer. There's more destruction of other species. And nowhere in the natural history of life itself has any species been able to expand into its particular niche without some kind of negative feedback, ultimate destruction, unless there's a moderation. And our reacting in the way we must to our own toxic waste is too slow, and it's putting in jeopardy the continuation of the human species as we know it.
Governor, give me a break.
I don't think
I've ever heard a doomsday scenario argued with more fervor. And when I think back to the limits of Rome debate and every other doomsday scenario I've heard, it never happened. People adjust. Why is it that you go to this extreme of suggesting that the world's about to come to an end?
It's not about to come to an end. It's about to change, and it is changing. It is not extreme when 170 nations in Rio in 1992 all agreed that the emission of greenhouse gases should be reduced to 1990 levels. That's not happening. Neither Clinton nor the Republican Congress gives a damn and are continuing this incredible creation of alteration in the natural environment. And we are a part of life itself. When we destroy part of that web, we are jeopardizing it. And it is not a doomsday to recognize when you have 6 billion people with incredible technology, it has a different impact when there's a few hundred million running around in a hunter-gatherer period.
I would just say again, you know, if we're going to be successful on those fronts, we've got to deal with the developing countries. We've got to deal with the countries that are behind the Iron Curtain that have the worst environmental record. That means that the kind of things that the companies I represent do and private capitalism in the world is a big part of the answer if we use it sensibly. Don't you agree that there ought to be a partnership between those of us who are interested in growth and jobs and the environmental progress?
A partnership, yes. If there can be a fundamental role for a principle of restraint, your central dogma of life is return on investment, uber alles. There is no competing principle. And unless one can accept what it means to be greedy, what it means to be envious, and what it means to be gluttonous, and really apply that across the board, then capitalism as an engine of production becomes toxic and ultimately lethal.
This may be superfluous, but go on the offensive now, Governor.
Okay. All right, let me, I want to know, do you agree with the newly appointed president of Burger King, growth, growth, and more growth are my favorite words?
I think that growth is important, but going back to the last point you just made, I think that growth without quality, growth without discipline is a cancer. And I think that if you're looking for a modern view of manufacturing and industry, I think that the people that I represent all believe that you need to have intelligent growth, you need to have quality, you need to have discipline, you need to have productivity. So growth, 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 no, I don't think that that's the way we ought to run the world.
So, for example, growth in in the consumption of cigarettes would not be a growth that you would recommend to your own family?
I think in general, I'm a pretty disciplined person, Governor, just like you are. And I think that those kinds of unlimited growth are bad from a personal point of view and from the view of an economy as well. You've got to have disciplined productivity and quality.
But no, the tobacco stocks are doing quite well. And by the principle of growth, what you said is some kind of personal idiosyncrasy at variance with the return on investment that governs a company like Philip Morris, isn't it?
I represent 14,000 companies, including Philip Morris, and I certainly am not here to defend every aspect of all of those companies. I'm here to suggest that the modern industrial system is one in which growth, growth, growth is not what we're interested in. In fact, we think there's a new paradigm that growth and environmental progress ought to go together. One of the reasons we think you've gone too far too fast is because you don't pay enough attention to growth and jobs. And we think sometimes in the past we haven't paid enough to environmental progress. Let's find a new paradigm in which we have both environmental progress and economic growth together.
Do you know of any company in the Fortune 500 which at its board meeting could adopt a principle, we don't need to grow at 15 to 20% a year anymore?
I think that if I look at 3M, Dow Chemical, Eastman Chemical, and a host of companies that were in my book, they would have all said that we should pursue our growth at the same time we pursue the kind of environmental excellence that they've achieved. And just to go back to the business about the ozone and the stratosphere, DuPont was the company that led that effort. And DuPont grows at a rapid rate. We're interested in growth. We're not here to reject growth. We're not for going back to the agrarian age. So we'd like to grow at 15%, sometimes more, but that does not mean that we're prepared to reject other values.
But within the framework of your economics, if you kill 400,000 people a year, that in itself adds to the gross national product because of the medical work that will be done here at the great medical centers. If people are killed in 40,000 a year in automobile traffic, that's all recognized only as growth. Your mention of quality comes from what? There is no principle within your basic dogma to recognize anything of moral restraint, anything of restraint on the environment. And in fact, most of the things that manufacturers adopt have only been due to the pressure of the environmental movement.
Well, first of all, I'd like to reject your moralizing about the issue as the sole criteria. I don't object to it being one criteria, but the notion that it's got to be moral in your terms or else is something I reject.
You think you'd apply cost-benefit analysis
apply economics to how we make choices about how we live in a very complicated, modern, global world, Governor. And I think that that means that you got to grow and you got to provide jobs. And, you know, what about all those poor people in the developing countries? What about those poor people who are in the ghettos of America? What do we tell to them when we say, let's do the environment no matter what?
All right. Good. I'm glad you raised that point, as a famous man used to say. Growth has been incredible the last 30 years, but the number of poor people, very poor people, starving people, now still ranges in the area of 800 to a billion people. So your growth in the accumulation of more commodities, more stuff, that keeps putting raising the marker is leaving all these people behind, and the gap between the rich and the poor in every nation in the world and between nations has gotten far worse as economics and the engine of capitalism has expanded.
You're just wrong about
all
your
right,
facts. You're just.
I mean, demonstrate that.
Well, first of all, there's been this extraordinary difference between growth in America and growth in much of the rest of the world, including the East European countries that were under communism, developing countries, even Europe, where growth has not been so good.
The standard of living in Mexico under our NAFTA has dropped 40%.
All of those countries have done poorly. You're right. And you see a disparity between income there, but they haven't had growth.
Even in our own country, the poor are getting poorer as your rich are getting richer.
So that doesn't show
me a growth of quality or justice, let alone any morality.
Okay, thank you. We've reached a point of satiety here.
Good. There is a point of satiety.
Professor Schmalensee and Professor Schmalensee will make an opening remark and then be questioned by the opposition team.
Well, I thought I might bring the debate back from the question of capitalism, yes or no, to the topic of the environment and environmental policy, to perhaps consider some choices that are on the table. I think it's fair to say that we are all environmentalists now in a sense in which we absolutely were not 20 or 30 years ago. I think that's a change for the good. I think in many respects, that's a moral change. But I think moral principles only take you so far in real policy choices. In environmental policy and in other policy, as in other policy areas, one wants the government to choose sensible goals and to choose policies that have the most bang for the buck. You want in this area, as in others, to obtain as clean an environment as one can obtain for the resources expended. And in that sense, and by that test, I think environmentalists have gone, if not too far too fast, at least in the wrong direction. I think the current debate over, and the debate we just heard over climate change illustrates this. Think about China for a moment. Does the issue of too much growth make sense in their context? The Chinese are trying to develop an economy in which most children are poor, in which there is and has been for a long time hunger, lack of education, and so on and so forth. They are doing that by burning coal. That is emitting carbon dioxide. Now, we can have an interesting debate about the consequences of that, but the fact is there are competing moral goods. The Chinese want to do well by their children and grandchildren in terms of food and clothing and shelter, and also in environmental terms. Discussing the issue on moral grounds does not help make those difficult choices.
Okay, thank you. Don't go away, Dr. Schmalensee. Mr. Poe.
Doctor, I'm curious if you believe that the government should make policy choices on where to set air quality standards on the basis of calculating the number of lives to be saved, calculating the cost to industry, and then attaching an economic value to each life and doing a cost-benefit analysis and letting that dictate the decision. Do you think that's...
At some level, I think there's no alternative. The current legislation says that air quality standards must protect human health with an adequate margin of safety, as you know. As you also know, I expect, the current scientific evidence says that there are no safe levels, so that if you emit a little less and you reduce atmospheric concentration, you have less risk. There's very little evidence, if any, if I may finish my answer, for thresholds. So if there are no thresholds and there is no absolute protection, you are always making a choice between more cost and more safety or less cost and less safety. That's inescapable.
In that sense, that's true, but would you actually attach a dollar value to a human life and then say, well, if the equation is positive, yes, if the equation is negative, no, and if so, what dollar value would you attach to a human life?
I think the important question really is to raise the level of debate so that the choice is recognized. If you view those standards as they are currently viewed in debate, the debate over the particulate standards illustrates it nicely. They're too high, they're too low. Well, on what basis? Neither side is able to articulate a basis for that. The environmental community says they must be tightened because, of course, they cause damage. The other side says they can't be tightened because they cause cost, because tightening would impose cost. Both are correct. A choice must be made.
All right, Mr. Linden.
I'm curious about this notion that we've gone too far and too fast on dealing with climate change. So as far as I can see, we've gone nowhere. Fossil fuel emissions are almost exactly as they would be if Rio had never existed. Secondly, in making a cost and benefit analysis about how to address climate change, you have certain assumptions about what climate change will be. The conventional wisdom is that it'll be moderate a couple of degrees or a few degrees over many decades. New scientific studies coming out of Greenland and examination of sediments and elsewhere have shown that perhaps the pattern in the past for climate change has been extremely abrupt and rapid change of very large magnitudes in just a few years. If that turns out to be the case, and there's been no evidence recently to contradict this, what effect would that have on your attitude towards the costs and benefits of dealing with this issue?
Well, let me deal with first your assertion and then your question. The assertion that we haven't done anything on climate change, I believe, despite all the rhetoric, is basically correct. I think the issue before us is, will we move rapidly without enough knowledge between now and December to put in place a regime that may be expensive and may produce few benefits? I do spend a reasonable amount of time with climate scientists at MIT, and you're right. The Greenland ice core does show past climate changes, having nothing to do with human causation, of course, being rapid in some cases. It's a very poorly understood system, I think is a fair statement. That means the stakes are very large on both sides. If we try to transform the world economy, or if we try to run the experiment without thinking and learning about the system.
Governor Brown.
I live next to the Amtrak railroad station in Oakland, and also a bus stop right outside my window. If I open my window, within 24 hours, dark carbon particles accumulate. I, as a owner of that property, object to that invasion of my land. Don't you agree that I should have a right to have the quiet enjoyment of my property without being invaded by that kind of chemical onslaught?
Well, the issue of who ought to have what rights is a very interesting one. If you play music, your neighbors might object to the music you play. Few rights are absolute, and it's few rights can be made.
But I'm not going using my property so as to harm someone else. I'm just asking to enjoy my own property without being harmed by others.
I see. And so you would require the bus station to move? Maybe I could finish the answer. You would require the bus station to move, or perhaps the bus system to be dissolved so that people just took cars instead of buses?
I don't care how they do it. I don't want carbon in my lungs or my bed or my bookcase just because somebody can't figure out a better way to move people around.
I see, Governor. So you would object to mass transit if it causes you inconvenience.
I would object to any invasion of my property when there's no reason. There's other ways to move people around, other forms of fuel. What I'm trying to point out is a contradiction between, on the one hand, saying private property is sacred, and on the other hand, of saying government can't stop the invasion of people's bodies, neighborhood, and everything else.
All right. Thank you, Governor. Thank you, Professor. Professor, it's your turn. Dr. Woodwell, it's your chance to make an opening statement. An opening statement from Dr. Woodwell.
Well, I'm delighted to learn that there isn't any question as to what direction we should be going in. And there is some basis for clear agreement with the opposition here. But we have a world that isn't working. It's not working in several ways. We are accumulating people at about 250,000 people a day, or 1 million people every 4 days, roughly 100 million people a year. We have this small problem with the warming of the Earth due to the accumulation of heat-trapping gases in the atmosphere. The Earth has been warming for the past century. It's been warming in the past 2 decades at an accelerating rate. It looks as though, if we continue on the current course, the Earth will warm into the indefinite future at an average rate of the order of 0.2 to 0.3 degrees per decade. That's an average rate for the Earth as a whole. That gets to be 0.5 to 0.6 degrees in middle latitudes. And in the high latitudes, even higher. That's intolerable. We are not going to keep a vigorous economy in the world and large numbers of people in a salubrious environment with the world changing at that rate. We have as well a progressive series of problems with the biotic impoverishment of the Earth, running down the capacity of the Earth for supporting living systems. We are all familiar with the demise of the fisheries in the Northwest Atlantic, but if we look around the world, the fisheries elsewhere have fallen into difficulties too. One further point, right. Only that the Earth is accumulating these toxins which we have been talking about. There are four topics now, each of which requires a major change in the direction of human affairs.
Thank you, Senator Craig.
George, we've got very accurate land-based temperature records now in the United States that manifest no warming trend over the past 100 years. We've got highly accurate worldwide satellite data that's just coming in now, spread over 18 years, indicating no warming trend.
Well, that isn't right at all.
Well, those are the figures that are given to us by our scientists. My guess is this. You proposed in a Smithsonian conference phasing out of fossil fuels. Do you give up your airplane ticket from here tonight and walk home, or how do you plan to get there?
We have to live in the context of our time. We all have to do that. But that doesn't mean we can't change the context. We have to change the context. No question about that.
But now, the science doesn't argue that at this moment.
Oh, yes, it does. The data on the temperature of the Earth are absolutely impeccable. One can go around and select out places where the Earth has cooled. There are other places where the Earth has warmed. There are wonderful data on Canada. Canada has a beautiful set of data going over 90 years. In the 90-year period between 1895 and 1990, the average temperature of Canada rose by about 1 degree centigrade. In the northwestern parts of Canada, the Mackenzie District, it rose 1.7 degrees centigrade. In the far eastern part, in the Davis Strait region, it cooled about 6-tenths of a degree or thereabouts. But totally consistent with the models that have set forth the changes in what's likely to happen as heat-trapping gases accumulate in the atmosphere. There is absolutely nothing wrong with the data on the warming of the Earth.
Michael, go ahead.
I'd just like to say that I think you're wrong about the data, that lots of people think you are, but let's assume that there is some sign that there is a relationship between human activity and global warming. I'd like you to tell me, if you would, George, what regime you would put in place in the next 6 months. You're a very smart fellow, I'm sure you could do a lot of it, that would identify what the goal would be, identify the means by which we reduce the greenhouse gases, the compliance mechanism that would enforce all of this, and at the same time, tell me, are you going to include the developing countries? Are you going to include China in this treaty, or are you going to leave China out?
Well, I'd be glad to solve this problem in two sentences. We should, of course, move very rapidly, and from a scientific and technical standpoint, we can't move rapidly enough. From the standpoint of your political and economic view, we can't move slowly enough. The technical details of what's happening to the Earth and the potential of the Earth for supporting your companies, your interests in an expanding economy, if we can have it in this circumstance, will not be sustained in a world that is warming on a continuous basis.
Can you answer all those? Can you answer all those questions?
The way to get around that, at the moment, as far as I'm concerned, is to develop a system for taxing the use of fossil fuels. Do it globally, but do it nationally immediately. Offer the leadership that the world needs. Have the U.S. offer that leadership by setting up a program for reducing the use of fossil fuels and subsidizing developing alternatives to the use of fossil fuels, including improved efficiency and the solar alternative, which is really the only alternative we have.
Doctor,
using that as a model for the world, giving the technology to get away from the use of fossil fuels to China and other parts of the world that are developing.
Dr. Schmalensee. Looks like we smoked out the sun worshippers here.
It's a sweeping proposal to which we will no doubt want to return, but I just wanted to make sure I heard you correctly. Are you really arguing that the climate models can explain past variation over time and space in climate? I mean, I have friends who do this for a living, and I'm surprised to hear you say that.
Listen, we've been working, the scientific community has worked on the warming of the Earth. We call it the warming of the Earth now, but it was the carbon dioxide problem just a few years ago, for 100 years. The appraisals made 100 years ago suggested that the accumulation of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere would warm the Earth, and the magnitude of the appraisals suggested a similar magnitude to what's occurring at the moment.
Is the answer to my question then no, when you look decade to decade or place to place?
No, the answer to your question is yes. We have good appraisals of what's likely to happen. The answer is that a hammer that drove a nail yesterday was likely to drive a nail tomorrow.
Okay.
The quality of the hold you'll get in that nail may vary because the wood varies and the quality of the nail varies, but the hammer will work.
The hammer is working. Thank you very much, Dr. Woodwell. Senator Craig. Opening statement and then submit to questioning.
Mike, you mentioned in my introduction that Republican policy and common sense didn't fit. Well, when it came to the congressional races this year, a majority of Americans still felt it fit. So with that in mind, let me suggest that the 25 years of devout environmental policy in this country have had some great successes, and I support those successes. None of us are advocates of smog-filled cities or rivers that burn or lakes that are neglected. Through leadership at the federal and at the state levels, we've seen tremendous progress, and I make this statement proudly. America is now the most environmentally protected country in the world. Our air is cleaner than most. People are more conscious of our environment than ever. We are managing our natural resources with more compassion and care than we ever have, and we are proud of those great strides. But let me suggest to you that there is a threat today, and it's a threat of our so-called environmental groups who think our country is still in grave danger, who are using the fear of fear itself as a weapon to launch massive campaigns to frighten and scare our public into believing that our forests, our lakes, and our rivers are in a death spiral of extinction. Carl used this in one of his letters recently when he said, and this was a fundraising letter, of course, We may be the last generation of humans to know the wondrous Earth as it was meant to be. Well, doggone it, it's time for a reality check, Michael.
Make it a quick one.
All right. The reality check is simple. The moral and the ethic of the environmental movement is good, and it's positive, and we recognize that as a country. And an overwhelming number of Americans accept it. But what we also must lay on the table is that good environmental policy cannot be bad for people. And this rush to judgment that we see today oftentimes sets people in the background, all for the evangelical environmental attitudes that persist.
Okay, don't go away. Mr. Linden.
If the American people support the Republican position as exemplified by the Contract of America on the environment, how is it that it was grassroots opposition to the various anti-environmental aspects of the contract that stopped it in its tracks? And if, in fact, the American people would still support the anti-environmental or the environmental reforms of the contract, why have none of them been reintroduced in this Congress with the same vigor that they were in the previous Congress?
Well, Mr. Linden, a lot of things are going on in this Congress that went in last Congress. Reform of the Endangered Species Act, that's going to be on the floor of the Senate this year to be debated. And I think it brings about the kind of balance of partnership, relationship with the private property owner and the public interest that we haven't had in the old act. That's a positive one. Let's talk about Superfund. You know, that was a marvelous tool for lawyers. It put hundreds of millions of dollars in the pockets of lawyers. And it didn't clean up a lot of sites. In fact, it cleaned up a great many less than it should have. Now, that's on the table this year. That hasn't come from the table. It was started in the last session of Congress. A great many of these things, as you and I both know, are important and sensitive issues. You don't accomplish them in a 1 or 2 year period. But many of them will be dealt with this year. They were started a couple of years ago.
Mr. Poe.
Senator, I think we may have some common ground here, some common sense common ground. In 1993, a wide range of interests, the Chemical Manufacturers Association, the Sierra Club, DuPont, the Automobile Manufacturers Association, agreed how to fix the Superfund. I'd like to put to you the question, will you support that package if it's offered on the Senate floor this year, the 1993 reform package, which, as I said, was agreed to by everybody from the Sierra Club to the Chemical Manufacturers Association?
There's a great deal of it I will support, and I think that's a package that will come to the floor. The one element of it, Carl, you know, that we're trying to deal with at this moment deals with natural resource or resource damage and how you equate that and make some sense of it so that all parties can participate in the recovery process.
With the exception of that component, you think that would be the right platform to reform the Superfund this year?
I think that's a very positive platform to start.
Thank you.
Governor Brown?
Is there, in your philosophy, any sense of enoughness, or does the process of extraction, throughput, and waste have to continue at the present rate?
Well, Jerry, I noticed in your resume that you're for zero population growth.
That's Carl Pope over here.
No, I saw that you were a supporter of it. Now, I guess that's a form of enoughness.
Bringing the population growth down. Let me throw that at you.
No.
How many people on the earth do you think we ought to have?
Well, Jerry, I'm not going to play the measurement game. What I am going to suggest to you.
Well, zero, you just threw one at me.
Jerry, enoughness in that business means the federal government or a government steps in and says, thou shalt not.
First, we got to decide on the end.
I don't believe in that kind of government. I don't believe in that kind of a dictatorial environment that destroys my freedoms. You may, but I don't.
Well, what's the goal? You said you don't like government doing it. If we could once agree on the goal, maybe we'll figure out some way for the Manufacturers Association to provide the solution.
Well, I think.
So, do you see any limitation? 30 billion people, 20 billion people. Where do you have any sense there's a limit somewhere in physical activity on the planet Earth?
I believe there is a limit, and I think those natural levels will be found, and they will not be dictated by government or government policy. They will be dictated by resource and economies.
The economists are going to become the dictators?
No. You know that I'm a firm believer in the marketplace and not the government dictate.
Neither one of them seem very attractive to me.
So I've noticed.
Quick one from Mr. Linden.
Going back to this earlier thing, the stock market plummets because the economic news is so good. I mean, if in fact these environmental regulations and laws that we've had for the last 25 years have gone too far and too fast, why is it not showing up in the economic data we see? Why do we have this booming economy?
Take 8 seconds to answer that.
8 seconds. I've endorsed what we've done in the past. And certainly industry
has gone too far too fast.
No, I've endorsed the environmental policies of the past that we've done very well.
You didn't endorse them in the past. You only endorse them after they've ever been put into place.
Oh, I think you're wrong, Jerry.
All right.
What I am suggesting is that when it comes to the argument of global warming and a plunge over the cliff, without the ability to make the kind of measurements that Jerry suggests, without knowing where we go and what it costs, you may well see a stock market plummet clear to the bottom.
Thank you very much, Senator. Carl Pove will make an opening statement and then be questioned by the affirmative team.
Americans do take pride in the environmental progress that we have made in the last 25 years, and they should. Fish have returned to the Cuyahoga River, which in the 1970s was so chemical choked that it burned. We banned DDT, and we saved the bald eagle. We got lead out of gasoline. We stopped putting our children at risk for loss of intelligence. But we still have a long way to go. 1/3 of Americans still breathe unhealthy air. 1 out of 4 lives within a bicycle ride of an uncleaned up hazardous waste site. 1/2 our lakes and 1/3 of our rivers are still not fit to swim in or fish from. And we continue to pour greenhouse pollutants into the atmosphere at a rate which last year brought dengue fever and malaria back here to Texas. We still have to fight to find out what companies are putting out into the air. Many of them and many of our leaders still resist telling us. But at the Sierra Club, we don't believe there's such a thing as water that's too pure for our kids to drink, air that's too clean for our parents to breathe. And we believe that a majority of Americans, regardless of ideology, regardless of political party, are deeply committed to continuing our progress at as fast a rate as we can at protecting America's environment for our families and our future. We trust the American people, and we don't believe the American people believe that we've gone too fast or too far.
Thank you. Mr. Buckley.
Do you trust the American people to decide how large their families ought to be?
Yes.
Well, what if they disagree with you?
I don't actually have an opinion on what every
family
should
do. Why don't you have
an
opinion on that? You have an opinion on practically everything else.
In a minute and a half, you've drawn an awful lot of opinions from me, Mr. Buckley. I think you probably have more opinions than I do, but you've had longer to accumulate them.
Opinions on my specialty. Mr. Pope, let me ask you this. You acknowledge that it requires considerable expenditures of capital to make any movements in the direction that you espouse. For instance, new technology to reproduce, to supplant the burning of fossil fuels. How is the accumulation of this capital going to be possible in the kind of ascetic society that Governor Brown tries to foist on us?
I heard Governor Brown is advocating a society with some self-restraint, something that I actually think that you as a conservative probably believe in your heart, although you may not like exactly his version of it. We are currently spending a very, very large amount of money to subsidize activities which destroy the environment. If we made our market system reflect more accurately all of the prices of the activities we engage in, we would find that investors would invest differently, different companies would grow more rapidly, cleaner technologies would supplant dirtier technologies. We have an enormous technological capability to make this transition, but we need to get the price signals right, and then we need to exercise some self-restraint. I don't believe, I am an optimist in this business, I believe that we have the capacity to continue making this kind of progress. I believe we have the capacity, in fact, to make much more rapid progress. And I don't believe that that will send the stock market into a crash. I think our economic system can adjust quite nicely to true prices, which reflect all of the costs and which protect people from what in a free society it seems to me is difficult to justify, which is one person's right to put something in my lungs which poisons me.
All right, Mr. Dr. Schmalensee.
It's music to an economist's ear to hear someone in your position favor using prices instead of fines and jail terms and so on and arbitrary standards. But let me go to one of your earlier remarks. You talked about greenhouse pollutants and you said the air can't be too clean. When I decide to pick up my kids at school, or when I decide to drive to the grocery store, when I turn up the heat, when I exhale for that matter, I emit carbon dioxide, which is a greenhouse pollutant in your terms. You said the air can't be too pure. That suggests no fossil fuels. Where do you want to go? You haven't given us a basis for choice or a way to make policy.
Well,
what do you mean by that?
I think that there might be a point at which it would be very difficult to decide whether we should go further in terms of reducing CO2 emissions, because there are some natural sinks of CO2 and the atmosphere has some capacity to handle it. Fortunately or unfortunately for the planet, fortunately for this debate, we aren't anywhere close to that point.
So you favor reductions in emissions?
I favor following what the scientists have told us. And the scientists have told us that in the case of greenhouse gases, we very, very badly need, as rapidly as possible, to reduce our emissions of CO2 by 20%, which is not 100%.
That's not science. That's your distillation of cost-benefit judgments. The science talks about consequences. You talk about what we must do.
The science suggests that if we wish to minimize the instability we create, if we want to buy a prudent insurance policy for the stability of global climate, which I think is something we should want to do, that at a minimum, we should reduce our emissions of carbon dioxide by 20% as rapidly as possible. We are nowhere close to achieving that.
Mr. Jasinowski.
Let me pursue that and ask you directly, Carl, on the global climate issue, about this issue of is it workable as it's now being considered. As you know, the plan is to leave all the developing countries out of the picture. They're the biggest source of greenhouse gases. The AFL-CIO says that's a grave mistake, and they go beyond that and say the exclusion of new countries such as China is going to end up causing the export of jobs, capital pollution, and will do
little or nothing to stabilize atmospheric concentrations of carbon. Professor Nordhaus, who signed the Economist Group, said, this won't work if you exclude all the developing countries. It'll have a devastating effect on the U.S. Okay. How do you square your support for moving forward quickly, 6 months, with that treaty when you're leaving all of these other countries out?
All right, quick answer.
The United States and the industrial nations need to leave, and the immediate follow-up to that treaty, as Dr. Woodwell said, should be to bring everybody else in and to start bringing carbon dioxide down globally. You're absolutely right. It won't work long-term if we don't include everybody.
Thank you very much, Mr. Pope. Mr. Buckley. You've been sitting there quietly emitting carbon dioxide for too long. This is your chance to be questioned by the opposition team. Who wants to start? Don't be afraid. Mr. Linden.
Well, let me ask you a question. The people of the United States own a lot of natural resources. And as a conservative, don't you believe that when they go to offer those natural resources, whether they're gold or timber or silver, that they ought to get the same return for their ownership as a private capitalist would insist on getting when they put their gold and their timber on the market? Shouldn't the government practice good business practices when it goes to lease minerals or cut timber?
Well, obviously, yeah.
Then why would you speculate on why so many conservative members of the Congress have consistently voted to continue to offer publicly owned gold and silver to mining companies, in many cases foreign mining companies, at prices that were established in 1872. There's nothing else in our economy that still goes for prices set in 1872.
Well, if the pricing mechanism is defective, let's do something about it. We give away the airwaves to television stations, even though we know, acknowledge they're worth, in many cases, hundreds of million dollars. I've got no problem at all with indexing prices set in 1870, do you? Oh, good.
Well, we have more common ground. Thank you.
Mr. Linden.
The resolution we're debating is whether we've gone too far, too fast on the environment, which I interpret to mean, have we, in environmental regulations, gotten ahead of the American people? In your own neck of the woods in Connecticut.
No, because the American people can be wrong. We're saying too far or too fast in our judgment.
So if the American people want more,
they can be wrong, sure.
Our government still could have gone too fast.
They were wrong in 1870.
Our government knows better than the American people. I thought the conservative position was the American people know all.
No, it isn't.
And that government
Quite wrong. No.
All right, so the government can then, if the government in its wisdom decides the American people are wrong, you would support that position if they went either too fast or too slow in the environment.
Well, now, wait a minute. Basic political philosophy in America acknowledges that the American people can't do certain things. A thing called a Bill of Rights prevents them from doing that. Now, by the acknowledgement that they mustn't do certain things in that area is a very broad commitment. They might be wrong when they vote for Democrats for Congress. That doesn't mean we want to repeal democracy, though, does it?
But we're talking about consistent polling data over time and expressed in the voting booth as well, that the American people have supported strong environmental legislation.
Polling data always acknowledge a paradox. The American people want free health and don't want high taxes. You can extrapolate from that into a series of paradoxes with which we are all burdened. They do not acknowledge that we're paying $1,800 per household for the current level of environmentalist laws. If it were plain that that was the case, they might say, well, we'll settle for $1,500 worth of environmental protection.
Well, what, I mean, maybe the problem here is, oh, sorry.
Governor Brown.
Mr. Buckley, are you at all troubled that China, in emulating the United States, which has 200 million vehicles for 265 million people, might have to have 900 million vehicles?
No, not at all. I've seen too many coolies in China to be encouraged them to go in any other direction.
So what is your principle of limitation? Is it economics? Is it pricing? Is that the total criteria that gives you comfort and direction in life?
It is a significant criterion. It is not one of the commandments preaches against greed, and I think it's a good idea to
stay in the way of greed, but the principal means of preventing an excess in greed is competitive. When the Chinese attempt something that is undoable, they will run into what Mao Zedong ran into.
Will envy be the way to control greed? Is that what I understand you to say?
I say the most effective way of controlling greed is competition.
Based on envy?
Based on what?
Envy. Keeping up with the Joneses.
No. If you are greedy to monopolize the sale of tires in Houston, I simply get in your way by making a cheaper tire, and your greed is therefore not satisfied beyond a certain level.
And what if the tire dust kills tens of thousands of people every year in the country?
Well, then people shouldn't drive.
But I can't stop other people unless we have some collective decision.
No, you can't. I'm sorry about that.
But I also can't stop. I'm sorry also. And the people themselves don't have much choice here in Houston to decide where they might live or whether they need a car, because the developers in the system has agreed that they'll spread
people
out.
People who decide to live in Houston presumably have weighed alternatives to living in Houston and elect not to accept any of those alternatives. We have a pretty free country with a 25% volatility in transient rates, which simply suggests that we have a pretty mobile population that decides where they want to live.
But no one is free if they live 20 miles from their job to walk every day.
Who said they were?
Well, if the way things are spread out between where people can afford to live.
If they want to walk to work, they should get a place closer to where they work.
I have the power to stop both of you, and I'm taking the power. Thank you very much, Mr. Barclay.
You're welcome.
Mr. Linden, captain of the opposing team, will now accept questions. Mr. Jasinowski.
I'm fascinated by your presentation today, Gene. I read your biography earlier, and you're so well written and researched. You obviously are a person who's an extraordinary expert on many of these questions, and you said at the top of the program that your objective was to be objective. And then in the course of the program, you have constantly referred to these public views about the environment, suggesting that, you know, if we could just poll the American people and do what they want us to do, we'd reach some sort of objective decision. Now, you have looked at the research here, and you know that the public often has very incorrect perceptions of risk, for example. The average person thinks x-rays are very dangerous, or at least many of them do, and experts think they're fine. I would like to know if you're interested in being objective or you're interested in polling the American people, and further, what are the one or two priorities that we ought to have in this environmental area, or should we go forward with everything?
All right. Answer your first question. I raised this data and this response to the contract and the consistent concern expressed by the American people to suggest not that the American people are right in all the details about every particular issue, but that it has become a value for the American people.
Well,
and
that's true.
The proposition before us is whether we've gone too fast. That value gets expressed inefficiently. I mean, we go overboard as a country in lots of other fields besides the environment. We go underboard in some. And the American people aren't going to fine-tune legislation.
Well, but should we poll them to know what to do about this trio,
I think what happened is, let's go back to 94 and the so-called Republican Revolution. All right, 39% of the electorate voted. The landslide involved about 21 or 22% of the people. Environment was not on the agenda in the fall campaign. It was almost never mentioned. It might have been mentioned in some of the Western states, but it certainly was not a dominant issue. Right after the election, with the dawn of Congress, of course, this whole agenda unfolds and a huge environmental agenda appears. What happened then? I think the American people were ready to sort of look at reform. Nobody likes government. Everybody believes that Congress can screw up everything. So with the idea that somehow real reform would come upon us, I think the American people welcomed that idea. Then what happened is it looked like these were like provisions that were sweetheart deals for various industries, rollbacks that would jeopardize the health of people, the Reg Reform Bill, where you had a case where industry lobbyists were actually briefing Congress on the details of the reg reform bill, an event so unusual that it showed up in the Times as an article.
People lost faith in the nature of reform.
You haven't answered my question.
That sometimes happens, Senator Craig.
I will answer your question if you like. But.
Mr. Linden, in your opening comment, you made reference to the earth and to this country as almost a barren landscape in which we had wiped out all of our forests. Sensing you might do that, I called the U.S. Forest Service yesterday, and here are some figures they gave me. See if you agree with them. 65% of the forested lands within our nation have now been set aside and will never be logged. The U.S. Forest Service grows 25 billion board feet more a year than is lost by natural fires or by harvesting. And we have 62 million more acres of forested land in the United States than we had in 1920. That seems to be a pretty respectable record, and yet I caught in your opening comments devastation and ruin.
Well, I was talking about this World Resources Institute report on frontier forests, which are basically pristine forest ecosystems, old growth, they're described in various ways. These are the richest ecosystems. There's no question that the eastern forests have been regrowing. Are these complete?
Are they not now valuable ecosystems,
even though at one time
they were almost totally clear-cut?
They were. No, I don't think they've recovered as ecosystems, and I think Dr. Woodwell would probably be in a better position to answer this question. But
Do you know they support more wildlife than they ever did prior to that? You have deer
and you have mice and such. You don't have the predators, and that was one of the reasons we had this explosion of Lyme disease, according to epidemiologists, which you had a predator-prey imbalance. They're not really reconstituted ecosystems. I mean, in terms of pristine forests, the U.S. only, if you exclude Alaska, it's less than 1%, putting us in that select company of nations, it's not a select company, the majority of nations that have cut most of their frontier forests. So the answer to your question is that, yes, there has been regrowth, and that's encouraged.
That is positive and should be talked about, should it not be?
Well, I think that the story of the regrowth of the eastern forests and the other forests is well known. I don't think it's hidden. But it is not the question of frontier forests. That's an entirely different issue, and that goes to diversity and other issues.
Thank you very much. You're free. Dr. Schmalensee and Dr. Woodwell. And Dr. Schmalensee, it's your opportunity to ask some questions of Dr. Woodwell.
Gladly. Dr. Woodwell outlined a very comprehensive proposal to deal with climate change, and I'd like to explore that and seek to understand it a little bit. You proposed a tax on carbon in fossil fuels. Have you thought about sort of, that obviously implies a tax on gasoline, it being a carbon-containing fossil fuel. What level of gasoline tax are you proposing?
Progressive. Rapidly progressive.
A penny a gallon? A dollar a gallon?
We can start with a penny a gallon. I would go to a dollar a gallon in a very few years.
Okay. Now, you're aware that the U.S. proposal, a U.S. negotiating proposal, isn't a tax. It's a cap on a legally binding limit on emissions. Do you disagree with that proposal? You'd use a tax instead?
I think that we should use all mechanisms that can be made to work.
Okay, even if they happen to be inconsistent. You also talked about the Chinese, and I think that's absolutely vital. I'd like to follow you down this path a little bit, because it's one that a lot of economists have thought about and worried about. If you say to the Chinese, as you propose to say, tax your fossil fuel emissions, tax the coal that you're burning in your power plant to generate the electricity to help you feed your children, they may not be too enthusiastic, and as you suggested, we might have to subsidize them. How much would you be willing to write by way of a check on the U.S. Treasury to the Chinese to encourage them to do this? Do you have any ceiling?
A good question.
Thank you.
I don't think the question of how much is a particularly pertinent question here. The question is how you get through the fossil fuel age into the age that follows. You have to go there through, first, economy in the use of fossil fuels, and second, replacing it.
Well, with due respect, the fact that reserves are limited means we will, one way or another, get through the fossil fuel age. You propose to accelerate that process.
Absolutely.
Rapidly.
Yes.
That costs money, you agree. That will take resources. We will be spending money to reduce the carbon dioxide in our grandchildren's atmosphere rather than, say, educating their parents.
Well, some people will probably be spending money, but I can figure out some ways where I save on fossil fuels. I just don't have to buy so much. And in the primitive world that I come from, a penny saved is a penny earned.
We all come from that world, but we do have to deal with the Chinese and the Indians who have more immediate problems than their grandchildren's climates. So you propose that the U.S. right send large amounts of money, people who've studied this think in terms of tens of billions of dollars, to the Chinese and Indians to reduce their fossil fuel, in addition to taxing our own use.
It's foreign aid to solve a problem, a global problem that everybody recognizes, and that if the president stood on the steps of the White House and said to the nation, fellow citizens, we have a serious problem. I propose to address it this way. I'm going to institute a tax on fossil fuels to reduce the accumulation of heat-trapping gases in the atmosphere and to solve a series of other problems. And I am also going to suggest that we develop in our foreign aid program the distribution of the best technology possible for jumping over the fossil fuel age and give that technology away to the developing world. We have already a multi-billion dollar foreign aid program involving several agencies, as you know. We can turn that toward this purpose. The purpose is serious enough that we should do it.
Of course, as you know, the studies that have looked at this talk about many multiples of our current budget being necessary for the sort of program you described. But I want to just make ask one last question, since my time is fading. There was mention made earlier to the phase out of CFCs, a goal that I expect we all agree with. Wasn't any mention made of widespread non-compliance with treaty obligations to phase out CFCs? That's a pretty cheap process for most countries, phasing out CFCs, a lot cheaper and easier than giving up on the fossil fuels. Are you worried?
No, before you say
can I just pose the question? Then you can answer.
All right.
Are you worried at all that we send billions of dollars to China and India to phase out fossil fuels, that they might not do it?
Oh, I'm perfectly aware of the scurrilousness of nations, of the fact that there are many nations that are run by a bunch of thugs.
I didn't mean to make that argument about China and India in particular, to be clear.
You can finish your answer and then go on the offensive.
Yeah.
But I think we have to deal with that, and there are ways of dealing with it. We have all kinds of ways of dealing with it. I acknowledge that without any question. Let me go back to the toxic substances problem that you addressed early in your remarks. You suggest that in addressing the cost of reducing emissions of fossil emissions from industry or whatever, that we consider human health and we balance off the costs in mortality against the financial cost of producing this improvement. Now, I accept the fact that we'd like to protect people. But it's also true that in the eastern part of the country, I can show that the amount of carbon that's fixed in photosynthesis by forests is reduced by 20% or so by the quality of air currently. That means that if we filter air and pass it over plants, why, those plants grow better than they do if you don't filter the air. Now, the cost of that, if we prorate it over the entire eastern part of the country, which seems to suffer from that problem, is just enormous. And cleaning up the air, you say, has an enormous cost too. What are the limits? Where do you go?
What's the cost? I've seen studies of the ozone effect on crops, and while it's there, I haven't seen it to be a large number. You talked about carbon fixation.
Well, just assume that it's a 20% reduction in the growth, which it is.
Assume a 20% reduction in agricultural productivity in the east?
Mm-hmm. Due to toxification
of
the air.
I need to sort of get myself on that planet.
And it also affects the growth of plants,
of all plants,
including trees. So we have a lower productivity. Let me go back just one step. The economy that you
Is there a question? I'm now around the assumption.
Well, I'm curious to just what you would suggest as to the cure. Is there, what's the limit to which we go? Do we do you stick to the human health standard, or do we look for a higher standard that protects not just people but their habitat?
No, I'm willing to look more broadly. I referred to the human health standard because that's the governing standard in the Clean Air Act. But plainly, I think if one looks at all consequences of environmental pollution in deciding on the appropriate level of policy action.
But is there any point at which we reach a level at which you abandon the criterion of financial cost and just decide we have to do it this way?
Well, I think it raises interesting issues of morality in some respects. I think most of the issues we've dealt with don't, in fact, come in that form. They don't come with if you do this, A happens, and if you do something else, B happens, and those are the only alternatives. Most of the problems we face, like urban air pollution, like carbon dioxide emissions, are ones in which if you do a little more or a little less, you get a little more or a little less. They're not problems with natural limits. So I think, in part, one of the things that's gone wrong in debates about environmental policy for the past 30 years or so is it's been framed as if there are thresholds and limits in circumstances in which there aren't, in fact, thresholds or limits.
So you agree that we probably haven't gone far enough and fast enough to accommodate this series of problems.
You know, I didn't think I said that.
Oh, I think you did.
I said you have a continuous choice. That's what I said.
Okay. Thank you very much, gentlemen. Mr. Buckley, the two team captains will now interrogate each other, Mr. Buckley and Mr. Linden. And according to my menu here, Mr. Buckley starts.
Mr. Linden, you perhaps caught the diffidence with which Mr. Woodwell said that if pricing were at his disposal, he'd increase the price of gas, you know, a little bit now, and maybe even a dollar off into the future per gallon. You are, I think, aware that gas does cost a dollar more per gallon already in Europe and has for some time. Now, the consequences of that increase in gas have had what on the consumption of fuel? Is it your judgment that it is totally elastic, i.e., if you increase the price by 10%, you reduce the consumption by 10%, or is there a degree of inelasticity involved here?
In terms of specifics, I haven't the faintest idea.
Well, I do.
But, but since this is a question to me, I'll try to answer
it.
What you do have with high gas prices in Europe and high gas prices in Japan are fuel-efficient cars, which were much more efficient than ours for a long time, as well as a rather nice mass transit system. There are other reasons, of course, as well. The price is always an incentive of some sort.
Why don't we use more fuel-efficient cars here? If, in fact, you are so confident that the increase in price of gas is going to regulate the use of it?
The price of gas at the moment, in Texas, it's about $1.15 a gallon for regular, which I think adjusted for inflation works out to about 20 cents in 1960 dollars. It's as cheap as it's been in 40 years.
No, I'm not asking you that. I'm asking you what miraculous effects do you anticipate, given that we have a perfect laboratory test in Europe, which hasn't settled any of the problems that worry you all so greatly?
Well, I think Europe, particularly some of the, like Norway and other countries, are infinitely better on a per capita basis on CO2 emissions, for starters.
Why haven't you mentioned that
78% of the electricity in France is generated by nuclear plants. Are you afraid that Governor Brown would faint?
Well, I haven't. It's interesting that there's a lot of things I haven't mentioned. And I was just getting to that, actually. As well as the fact that most of Norway's power, a good deal of it comes from hydro, which is a bête noire. I probably differ with a lot of environmentalists in that I'm probably a little more open to nuclear power, so I'm not going to debate the prospect here. Well, it turns out to be extremely expensive, and I'm not sure it's efficient. I think in terms of moving from whatever fossil fuel generation towards some other type of fuel cells or solar or some other type of power, the marketplace is a fine way to do it at the moment if, in fact, the price of fossil fuel was burdened with its true cost to society.
Well, let me phrase my question more acutely. What makes you as confident as Mr. Woodwell apparently is that by increasing the price of gasoline even to that far-off figure, the way he puts it, of $1, mm-hmm. he's going to have such a wonderful consequences? Might not technology or use adjust to it, for instance, by making more fuel-efficient automobiles, doing whatever? In other words, what makes you so sure that the total millions of tons now used won't be equal to that by such measures as Mr. Woodwell advocates?
Well,
answer that question, then go on the offensive.
All right. I think that if, getting back to this question, if the market could solve this question, if in fact fossil fuels were burdened with their true cost to society, I think the price of power from alternative sources has been coming down steadily. And it's been coming down steadily because most of these people who are involved in this now, the subsidies have disappeared, all but disappeared for them, are free marketeers. They know they have to make it in the marketplace. And if trends continue, certain things like solar and, God knows, wind power and fuel cells will be competitive with fossil fuels in just a few years. I think if they had a level playing field where, I mean, there's an enormous subsidy for fossil fuels, not just the health costs that it puts on people, not just the cost to imposes on the world in terms of potential for global climate change, there's also actual subsidies within the energy budget for fossil fuel research. It dwarfs any other type
of
research.
Parsing,
we were just talking about the tax
cost of a gallon of gas is over 50% right now. Mm-hmm. So there's a sense in which you already have a recycling into the economy of a cost of using a gallon of gas, don't you?
Yes, you do. But you also, I mean, the fossil fuel debate is a type of social trap in that it's easy to use now and the costs are off in the future. I think it's called a time delay trap by social scientists, if I'm not mistaken. How do you adjust for this? Well, it's like smoking. You smoke now, you get cancer later. How do you bring the costs of an activity that are off in the future to the present? There's three ways. One is through regulation.
This is your question.
Second is through trade-offs. I'm asking you if you... second is through trade-offs like taxes, and the third is value change. I mean, do you think... is it a goal to be aspired to reduce fossil fuel emissions, starters? And if you did accept that as a goal, that climate change was a problem that the humanity faced, how would you get there?
Well, the most obvious way to diminish consumption is by making it more expensive. But you do run into the fact of inelasticity. And you also run into the factor of the trade-off. Are people willing to live 2 years less than they otherwise would if they ate only carrots? The answer is no. They're not willing to elongate their life by 2 years. So these are the kind of these are the data that we want to absorb and factor into these dreamy nostrums of yours, if I may pay you a compliment.
All right. What if you were going to rank your environmental priorities? What are the most urgent issues that you would How would you rank them? What do you think we should be addressing in terms of environment?
I want clean water and I want clean air.
That's it.
Is there a third?
Well, diversity, wildlands. I mean, you're a sailor. I suppose ocean pollution would be something.
I got water in there.
Okay.
No. I mean, I'm in favor of the spotted owl as an abstraction. I'm not sure whether I would give my life multiply.
Now that you brought it up, let me ask one last question
very
here.
Quickly.
Do you think that we need healthy ecosystems as a species, or are these just an amenity?
No, I think we profit from them. We don't need them. They don't have them, for instance.
We don't need nature, then.
Well, of course we do. But I say we don't need it. A lot of people living in Shanghai, and if you haven't been there, which I'm sure you have, it's a noisome place to breathe or to move about in. But a lot of people live there. Ditto Singapore and Hong Kong.
Well, they depend on ecosystems elsewhere, are they
not? Thank you. Thank you both. You've established that you're pro-spotted owl and anti-carrot, which I think is... And Mr. Jasinowski, who on the opposition team has a question for Mr. Jasinowski? Mr. Pope.
Mr. Jasinowski, I'd like to...
No, I don't think so.
In the course of the clean air debate this year, a number of people associated with the industry side have argued that we should not proceed to tighten air quality standards for soot and smog. And in the course of making that argument, which I believe you share, I think that's your position, they have said, one, that we should not tighten the air quality standard on ozone because it isn't really a serious health problem. Its health effect at the levels presently allowed is a loss of lung function by children of 20% to 30%, and that's not a serious health problem. I'd like to know if you agree with that statement.
Right. Well, I don't agree with your statement because I think what it does is it tends to put the debate as much as you can into the notion of the...
That wasn't my statement. That was the statement of the Vice President of the American Automobile Manufacturers Association, which I just quoted and asked you whether you agreed with it. That was not my statement.
Yeah,
for the
well, I didn't realize that. I certainly, in neither case, do I agree with that statement. And I think what it tends to do is to try to put the whole issue in the context of either making victims out of the people affected or suggesting that there's no harm at all to people who are affected. I think that what you have to do in all of these cases is to try to look as carefully as you can at the science and determine what the effect is. In other words,
if there is an effect, should you then act to protect people from that effect?
And if there's an effect, as we have done on clean air, I mean, we've made great progress on clean air, as you know, Carl, then we ought to continue to proceed. And so far, as you know, there's a big dispute about the science in this case. And there are people who argue on both sides of it, and no one is really fully resolved on it. And in fact, in some cases, there's a big debate over getting the Harvard studies associated with that.
Let me then.
If the science shows that it has an effect, we should move ahead.
All right.
If the science shows it has an effect, we should move ahead.
Yes.
So let's move ahead. Dr. Woodwell.
I'm interested in growth. You represent a large number of companies. Each one of which has as an objective profit. And company also has no obligation to social advancement of the nation. Its first obligation is to make money. Now, I'm interested in the limits of growth in those companies. How do you determine how those companies must limit themselves or be limited? Will they limit themselves, or do we have to have some bedrock layer of regulation produced by government in the public interest to assure that their aspirations for profit don't infringe the general public interest?
I think it's an awfully good question. I think in the first instance that the private market capitalistic system in the pursuit of profit is going to lead to the best results in most cases, and that's why we've got the strongest economy. We've made this extraordinary comeback that
Gene was referring to earlier, the capacity to change, innovate, and improve in the market economy is what makes us different from the communist economy, and that's why we've been so successful. Having said that, it's not a perfect system, and the reason that we now have environmental regulations is because of the thought that the market can't cover externalities, as you know. And therefore, yes, of course, you need regulations where the market can't cover certain things, and clean air is one of those examples. That's why we have the Clean Air Act. That's why we've made great progress on it. And the issue now, and we've had pretty big success, and it has not hurt our growth. The issue now is how do we change the way in which we grow and how we manage our environmental policies so that we can continue on that process, because it's getting more and more expensive as you move to trying to do a better and better job on the air.
Okay, I think we're going to call that the end. Thank you very much. Sure. Governor Brown, this is the affirmative team's chance to question Governor Brown. Dr. Schmalensee.
Governor, as you know, in developing countries, there are many sick, malnourished, poorly sheltered, poorly clothed people. There are immediate environmental problems. Millions die from dirty water. Heard about Shanghai. You can cut the air in Shanghai. It's hard to breathe it, but you can cut it. And they have lots of lung problems. In those settings, first, how would you apply the doctrine of restraint that you have been preaching to us? And second, how would you interest those people in dealing with the climate change issue, given their more immediate problems?
By not modeling a completely unsupportable type of lifestyle. The idea that it takes a ton of steel to get people to the grocery store or to work it's an absurd and a very destructive way to live. Now, that's the model. If China picks that up, then that becomes a threat to the entire world. There's something called alternative fuels. There's something called mass transit. There's something called a convivial city where people can walk to work. There is a way to live together that's compatible with other species as well as some kind of sanity. So it is not a question of restraining wisdom or the growth in quality. It's a matter of curbing the excess of extraction and material throughput and waste.
Does this model now exist on this planet?
It exists. It certainly exists in some places more than others. There are places where the consumption of energy, parts of Europe, Japan in some respects, you can find a high quality of life with a smaller throughput of material or waste and extraction.
So, but you will agree that all of those places, the Europeans, the Japanese, have carbon dioxide emissions, just to focus on one, that are a substantial multiple of Chinese per capita emissions?
We know the developed world is putting out more in aggregate if you look at the United States and the Soviet Union. But I can just tell you from my own city of San Francisco, where I was born, there were more people in 1940, and there was more rapid transit, less cars, less fossil fuel. So there is a way to have a very rich, complex civilization without wrecking the underlying natural base on which humanity depends.
Let me pursue that same question, Governor, because I think the notion that we can do more with less is absolutely on target, and in fact has to do with the success of the manufacturing comeback I spoke about earlier. You look at the average manufacturing firm today, it uses 40% less space, about half the energy it used to use, doesn't use as many people, tends to be much more environmentally sensitive in the notion of recycling toxics. And I'm sure, and is very focused on quality improvement, I'm sure you've seen lots of companies like that. Haven't you seen it, and isn't that a role model for success? Can't we do that? Can't we take successful companies who do more with less and improve the environment and say that's a successful role model?
Very much, except for one problem, that needs are created as fast as goods. So the escalation in what human beings conceive as necessary or as available luxury is growing so quickly that along with whatever progress, we have this increased demand. I used to think DOS was all right, and then I had to go to Windows. And now I'm at Windows 95, and Windows 97 is coming out. Instead of a relatively small memory, a small disk storage.
Aren't you pleased?
Well, I keep buying the new one, but I notice that I'm happy I can...
Why do you buy the new one if you're not pleased by it?
All right, that's a rhetorical question.
Because I can afford it, but I the logic of having to constantly buy more just to stay even, it's self-defeating. And that is the problem. The industry not only satisfies needs, it produces needs. And that is the vice in this whole business of being efficient. Yes, gasoline consumption isn't going up, even though car miles driven is growing, and yet there are more people, therefore there's more impact. We need a principle of restraint.
Does that imply intellectual curiosity?
No, curiosity is fine.
Why?
Why?
It increases curiosity.
No.
The more you know how much you don't know, the more you want to know how much you don't know.
Right. No material waste in intellectual curiosity.
Thank you very
and
much.
And yes, I do believe a happy asceticism is what is required.
Thank you very much. Senator Craig, Mr. Pope. And Senator Craig, you will begin by questioning Mr. Pope for a few minutes.
Carl, I viewed a couple of interesting polls before I came down to Houston that were taken in 1965 and 66. One poll said that 64% of the American people thought the leader of environmental organizations always took the more extreme position. 64% said more extreme than the average citizen. One other poll said 63%. Now, I understand, you know, that's kind of marginalizing the issue. Your organization has membership decline and it's got some budget problems. Is it because you are more extreme than the average environmentalist and ought you not change a bit?
Well, let me first of all, was that poll 1965? You said 1965, I'm not sure.
And one in 66, yes.
Okay, so we're talking here about what people thought 30 years ago.
No.
Now, you said, well, I'm
no, excuse me, 95, 96, sorry.
Thank you, okay, that does make a difference.
Thank you for correcting it. That's the only portion of it I misspoke.
Okay. Well, no, you're actually wrong. Our membership is actually increasing, and we're in very solid budgetary shape, so you misspoke there, too, although you may have been reading some newspaper stories from a couple years ago. And as you know, the press often covers bad news about anybody, not always the good news.
So I've noticed.
We have consistently gone out, and we also try to understand where how the American people feel about these issues, because, as Mr. Buckley said, this is a democracy, and at the end of the day, the government is supposed to, within the limits of the Bill of Rights, give people what they want. And if people want cleaner air and cleaner water and more wildlife, that is what government should give them.
Can I finish? Yeah.
And the polling we've done shows that, in fact, the American people are very grateful that the environmental movement is out there because they believe...
Well, that's not the crux of my question. I would agree with that poll.
Okay. And they're glad we're out there because,
frankly,
they think...
What they are saying is that...
Can I finish my statement? They're glad we're out there because, frankly, they think that the other leaders in this society are too focused on the short term, that they don't look for the future enough. They are too focused on next quarter's bottom line, next year's election. They want the environmental community to be out there ahead, pointing to the future and saying, this is where we need to go in the long run, and they support us in that. Every poll we've seen shows that the positions which my organization takes are supported, with very few exceptions, by majorities of the American people.
Ben, if you've been so successful in those areas, let me suggest that you've missed in one. Last year, you didn't fire a fellow by the name of William Arthur, regional director for the Sierra Club in the Northwest.
Yes, I know Bill very well.
Who is an absolute advocate of not cutting any trees on public lands, and yet clear-cut his own property and cut down a 276-year-old cedar tree. And you didn't fire
Senator Craig. Senator Craig, if we're going to discuss that incident, you have attacked an individual who is not here for the record to defend.
I did not attack him. I asked why you didn't fire him.
And if you don't think you attacked him, I'll let the audience judge whether you attacked him, Senator. I think you attacked him. He did not clear-cut his property.
Well, he left a few straggler trees, Senator, the article said. I will have to agree with that.
He carried out private logging, which the Sierra Club is not opposed to. We, in fact, are not opposed to logging everywhere.
Now let's talk policy here. You
Senator,
are opposed to logging on public lands.
That is correct.
But you are not opposed to logging on private land.
That is absolutely correct.
The millions of acres of private land that make up the ecosystems of our country, you're not opposed to logging on?
We are opposed to properly managed logging on private lands.
But not on public lands.
That's correct, Senator, okay. Because we believe that America's public lands, and a majority of the American people agree with this position, should be managed not for the profit of timber companies, but should be managed for wildlife, for watershed protection, for recreation, for the American people.
Private lands should not be managed for those resource values.
Private lands should be properly managed for the preservation as necessary of ecosystems, and in some cases we will need to
do that and log too?
All right, go answer that and then.
That's an interesting question.
Now, you can log land in ways which will maintain certain environmental values indefinitely, and we should.
Good.
There are some environmental
values.
Private? You could log public land that way, but unfortunately we haven't. And we are now down to the point where we have so little primary ancient forest in this country that we need to protect what we have on public land because, frankly, it is appropriately easier under the Fifth Amendment to restrain our logging activities on public lands than it is on private lands, something I think, Senator, you agree with.
Thank goodness.
Go ahead and ask the Senator some questions.
Well, we've been talking about common sense, Senator, and I'm going to offer a common sense proposition. I'm not asking, this is not the question. And my common sense proposition is that when people give politicians hundreds of thousands of dollars, they're making an investment by and large, and they expect a return. Mm-hmm. And I am struck by the fact that you said earlier that you thought that we should not sell gold and minerals on public lands for 1872 prices. But in the last Congress, you voted to continue the practice under the 1872 mining law.
That is
Can
wrong.
I finish?
No, you can't finish a false question. I did not vote that way. Thank you.
Senator.
Carl Pope, I authored the 1872 Mining
Senator,
Law Reform Act that for the first time perpetrated hard rock
Senator,
mineral revenues.
Senator Bumpers offered an amendment on the Senate floor which would have extended a one-year moratorium on the patenting of public gold, minerals, and other valuable property under 1872 mining law terms for one more year because Congress had not yet reformed the bill, mm-hmm. and you voted against the continuation of that moratorium.
You voted
to continue the patenting in 1996. That was the vote you cast on the Senate floor, Senator. It is not a false statement.
It is a false statement in the context of the bill that it was with, which was a mining law reform bill that I authored that for the first time, Carl, established a hard rock mineral royalty that we've never charged in this country.
And the
that increased the sale of the public domain at the surface level to market value and that the president vetoed.
Senator, you have consistently, with all due respect,
for three
voted.
Years running, right, introduced hold on, mining law reform.
Hold on. Make
you
your
have
point,
consistently please. Voted against the reforms which environmentalists and Senator Bumpers have offered, which would in fact restore mining on federal lands to a parity with those on private lands. The federal government currently gets nothing. You have proposed some very inadequate reforms. They were rejected, and then you voted to continue. You said, let's let these guys keep coming and getting gold and silver on the public lands under 1872 prices. You didn't vote to continue the moratorium. You could have done that and said, I'm voting for this moratorium. I'll be back next year with my bill. But in the meanwhile, let's not give gold and silver away. That's not how you voted. And I will offer the evidence that the mining companies have given you substantial campaign contributions, and I imagine they're very pleased with your vote.
That's the beauty of public disclosure.
Okay. Thank you very
Carl is absolutely right. I have taken contributions from mining companies. That's a fact, and that's fully public disclosed. What is also a fact is that I have been the leader of reform law that dramatically changes the environmental policies in mining, and in many of them, Carl has agreed with it.
Okay, thank you very much. If you're going to agree, we're going to get rid of you. Closing arguments, Mr. Linden. Mr. Linden, closing for the opposition.
Well, I have the impression that those in favor of the proposition agree with the opposition, at least thus far. Let's talk about risk a little bit. Look at the CFC question, which we alluded to during this debate. The risk arose in the mid-70s when people, when chemists saw that there was a chance that CFCs would affect stratospheric ozone in the upper atmosphere. We took action. We banned propellants and spray cans. There was much crying in industry. And then we were going to ban the use of CFCs across the board in the early 1980s. And lo and behold, the Reagan administration comes in. One little model shows that maybe the reduction isn't so bad. And all action halted for the next 6 years. In the meantime, scientists discovered an entirely new chemistry was at work in the upper atmosphere, the chemistry that produced the ozone hole. And so the risk actually was far greater than the risk that was perceived at the time that legislation was being made. Look at PCBs, the same thing. At first, there was a fear that they were a carcinogen, dismissed. Much was made about the fact that we overreacted to PCBs. Now there's a fear that they may be affecting the endocrine system of the entire biosphere, including humanity. That question has still not been settled. Are we going too fast on these chemicals and sort of acting without proper information? Half the time, or I can't say half the time, but often the risks are greater. Mr. Buckley has mentioned that perhaps we can get along without ecosystems. I doubt if many Americans agree with that. He's also mentioned this figure of $1,800 per person that we spend on environmental protection for a household. Or let's say it's 1 to 3%. If, in fact, we define well-being in America as consumption, as economists tend to do, then this is a drag on the economy. But what if Americans believe that a sound environment, healthy environment, is part of their well-being? This is not a drag on their well-being. And so maybe the problem is the way in which we look at consumption and the way in which we look at well-being, and not whether we've gone too far too fast in the environment.
Thank you, Mr. Thank Linden. Mr. Buckley, closing for the affirmative side.
Mr. Chairman, I think the problem with these echo freaks has to do with a failure sufficiently to appreciate that which has lightened the load of mankind. The level of life between Julius Caesar and George Washington didn't substantially change. What changed then was the increase in individual power through the use of industry. Lincoln Steffens, when the Russian Revolution came in, said, now we have socialism plus electricity will give us a human paradise. He was wrong in respect of socialism, but he wasn't wrong in respect of his idea that electricity is something that augments human power. Mr. Governor Brown asked, the head of Burger King says growth, growth, and more growth. Now, the head of Burger King isn't asking us all to get fatter. He's asking us to use more of his Burger Kings and fewer of his hot dogs. This is a perfectly legitimate enterprise, so far as I can see. Now, those who are like Governor Brown want to sleep in hammocks and be sheltered by wigwams are perfectly free to do so. But the notion that his form of reductionism, which would appeal to St. Francis of Assisi, is one that he ought to foist on us, seems to be something that we should most gently but most firmly reject. We should celebrate the extent to which humankind has benefited from ingenuity, from enterprise, and from the multiplicity, the great enhancement of power that comes to us as a result of industry. In acknowledging this and being barred in favor of it, we're not saying that we are against clean air or against clean water. We're saying that to the extent that you lose sight of the perspectives, you are doing damage and hurt to a humankind that yearns throughout the world for some measure of relief of the kind most Americans have enjoyed.
Thank you, Mr. Buckley. Well, time is one resource that is definitely fixed, and we've reached our limit, if not our satiety, Governor Brown. And I think that this debate actually was very productive, in my view, because I've listened to a lot of environmental debates, and typically one side says you can protect the environment at no cost to the economy, and the other side says you can have economic growth at no cost to the environment. And I think both sides here have acknowledged that there is a trade-off. Governor Brown is especially frank about the trade-off. He says industrialism must be pulled back at least a notch or two in order to have a clean environment. And this side was quite clear in emphasizing cost-benefit analysis, and I think that's progress of a sort, at least. I'd like to thank the debaters. There was very little recycling of arguments here tonight, which I think is good. I'd like to thank the Hatton Sumner Lecture Series of the National Center for Policy Analysis. I'd like to thank the audience here at Rice University, the producer Warren Steibel, and Firing Line, South Carolina Educational TV. Thanks very much. Good night.
This program is a Warren Steibel production in association with South Carolina ETV. Funding for this firing line debate was made possible by a major grant from the Hatton W. Sumner's Foundation. Additional funding was provided by the John M. Olin Foundation, the Annenberg Foundation, and the Laurel Foundation. For a video cassette of this two-hour debate, send $49.50 to Firing Line, 2700 Cypress Street, Columbia, South Carolina, 29205. State the subject of the debate and please allow 3 weeks for delivery.
This is PBS.
For a transcript of this two-hour debate, send $10 to Firing Line, 2700 Cypress Street, Columbia, South Carolina, 29205. State the subject of the debate and please allow 3 weeks for delivery.